Okay, let's start. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming. Some years ago, I started working for a very small IT department in a Polish company. And this small IT department was doing everything. It was incident response, it was reverse engineering, malware analysis, even IT security projects. I highly recommend that kind of experience. Whenever you are exposed to different areas of security, you can choose the one that you like the most and you would like to pursue in your career. And as you can tell from this slide, I chose reverse engineering. And as you can also tell from this slide, I'm no longer working for that Polish company, although the accent is still there. So what I discovered about reverse engineering and something that drives me particularly in reverse engineering is complexity. I don't know if some of you share the same feeling, but looking at the like highly obfuscated, encrypted, multi-state malware is something that I just enjoy doing. But a different layer or a different meaning of complexity is also worth contemplating. And there is a very complex piece of software that I guess everyone here in this room uses and a lot of people outside of this room use, and that's the operating system. On any non-trivial device, when you run your operating system, it's probably a slightly complex piece of software. So looking at such a complex piece of software is also a challenge. These challenges, the challenges that come from looking at Android, are the subject of this talk. And today I'm going to show you my journey and what I did in this space. But first we will start with the Android journey. And I will tell you a bit of the high-level overview of how an Android device is being made. I will show you the problems with the system image analysis, and this will be made through three different real-world case studies that I was part of. So let's start our journey. First thing is I will tell you what the Android device or making an Android device usually entails. And this is just a very high level overview. In fact, this overview is so high level that it can be applied to many different devices, not only Android ones. So the device that I have here, which is my personal one, and the devices in your pockets, just out of curiosity, how many of you use Android? Okay, there's a fair number of people that use Android. So the devices in your pockets, whether you use Android or not, are made out of different hardware components, and probably many of different hardware components. And these all hardware components come with their own software. So whether you have a Wi-Fi chip, or you have a system on chip, or you have some security chip that's proprietary, or you have some other wonderful hardware feature of your particular device, it not only comes with that hardware, but it also comes with additional software, which is kind of obvious when you think about it, because the hardware has to run somehow and has to somehow be visible to whatever wants to use it. So while this is not a very great insight, when you think about it from the reverse engineering perspective, you have more to analyze than just the operating system. You have these additional pieces that are in many different devices. And these pieces come with their own code that's a part of the device or the system image. So this is all put together by the ODM, which stands for Original Device Manufacturer. It's all put together in this wonderful wonderful package that is a phone. And then the third-party services may be added, so additional software features, just purely software-based features. And on some phones, that can be, for example, face unlock. That may be a purely software feature that interacts with the hardware, but it may be added by the third party, so it depends on whether the ODM or OEM have capabilities to build their own software feature, or they may subcontract it to another company. So that all comes together and is put together by the OEM, which stands for original equipment manufacturer, and that OEM is what you all are probably familiar with. That's the company that your phone is marketed by. And that goes to the shop. Users buy it in wonderful boxes, and they unpack it and they install apps. And these apps can also contain the software that's provided by this same third-party company. And also, during the first setup of the phone, additional apps may be installed or updated, or the software may change. So today, I'm going to talk to you about the system images, which come from, as you can see, various sources and various companies that produce the system image that runs on your phone. And that system image is analyzed by us. And the way it's analyzed is there are several tests being run. So because there are multiple different components that come in play, it's not only the Android operating system that's running on your device, most likely. Then we have to make sure that whatever was added didn't break the compatibility with AOSP, which stands for Android Open Source Project, and this is what the compatibility test suite is about. Then there are additional tests. If you want to license Google Apps or Google Mobile Services, you go through a GMS test suite. There is also a check for the compatibility with the hardware abstraction layer, which is VTS. There's a security test suite, which checks if the security patches were applied correctly. And there's this last one, which is the one that I'm most involved with, and it's called build test suite, and this reviews the whole system image for malware or other harmful behaviors. So when I talk about malware and Android malware, what you usually think of is an app that's, you know, somewhere there in the ecosystem. That may not necessarily be the case with the system images, because system image is not just the apps that come on your, with your phone, it's also the other elements. And we will see that in a moment in the case studies that I will present to you. So this is a very high level overview. If you're still wondering what this first part is about, because it sounds like compatibility is not really very descriptive. So there is a list of requirements. It's called Android Compatibility Definition Document. There's a link in the slides. You can click on it. And it has many, many different sections. And for example, section 9 is the one that I'm most familiar with. And this deals with the security model compatibility and contains subsections like permissions, premium SMS warning, security features, storage encryption, or even automotive vehicle system isolation. So this deals with a lot of different aspects of Android. And as you can see, it's not only the Android that it takes into account different uses of Android, not only phones. So we will now go straight to the case studies, which I guess is the most exciting part for those of you. It's definitely the most personal part for me, because I took part in all of them and reverse engineered it. But the case studies will also highlight some of the challenges that I think differentiate this analysis from a regular Android app analysis. And this is what I want to highlight in this talk, to tell you what really is the difference between analyzing an app and analyzing a system image. And on a very high level, when you think about it, the app is like an independent unit of code. It's just, it comes within a package. You have everything you want to see, well, except for maybe something that is downloaded from the network, but all the stuff is there. And you can analyze it as a separate entity. That may not necessarily be the case for the app that's pre-installed and runs on the system image, because this app can assume some stuff about the device, because it knows what device it's running on, right? So it knows, for example, that there will be some kind of hardware there. And the first case study will highlight the dynamic analysis challenges, and it's an app called device monitoring. It's also chronologically the first case study that I came across with the system images. So the app that I looked at had this weird entry in Android manifest. And this weird entry is here at the top. And this is the intent receiver, or broadcast receiver, sorry, for that's called app monitor receiver. The app was called device monitoring. And it has all the intent names. So the intent names are app on create, app on resume, and load URL, which are kind of worrying when you think about it. And you can make some assumptions about what's going on, but assumptions are your enemy when you are reverse engineering stuff. Don't make assumptions. It can go wrong in many different ways. So what I did is I looked at this broadcast receiver and tried to figure out what it's really doing. So it's doing a very simple stuff, a very simple action. When it receives such intent, it checks whether the intent is equal to load URL, because this app only deals with load URL. I guess it was an older or a newer version that simply ignored the other two. So if it's the load URL intent, it calls a method called adds URL and pack name to database. And now a thing about method names is when you're a reverse engineer, you know not to trust any method name. They can lead you in wrong direction. But in this case, it was pretty straightforward. So the intent expected two extra fields. The two extra fields were URL and pack name. And it really did put them into the database. I spared you the horrible SQL that was in this app. But it really did put that into the database. And then the database was sent over network to some remote server. So, and this is all this app does. It takes an intent, receives an intent, it receives two extra fields, puts them into the database, and sends them over the network. It's not malicious, this behavior, right? It's not something that's necessarily in any way malicious, because it simply receives some data and sends them over the network. We don't have a context to know what the data is, right? So the context to the data, I tried to find the context to the data. And the first thing I did, and it's probably the first thing you all would do, is I looked for any app that sends these intents. So I searched for any app that will send this intent in our app corpus, and I couldn't find anything. So then I noticed that this app comes pre-installed on phones, and it's really just a small number of phones. It's not evenly distributed, or you know, it's not evenly distributed through the ecosystem. So I took a look at the system image, and I downloaded the system image, and I used the most powerful reverse engineering tool known to mankind, that's called grep, and I looked for these intent names, and they were there. And one key insight here is, sometimes not everything has to be encrypted. Sometimes there are just the strings are just there, especially if the app wasn't really in any way obfuscated. So I found two places where these intent names were in the system image. The first name, the first place was the AOSP activity class. So AOSP, again, Android open source project. This is the operating system. It's open source, so the OEM are free to add stuff, and they add some wonderful features that users want. In this case, they added this particular method. This method, what it did is it just got the package name of the activity and then sent an intent with that package name. And if you don't know that, on Android, activity class is the one that is used by every single UI, probably every single UI in every single app. So whenever you see any UI, whenever you interact with any UI, this activity class will be used. So this method was unused, which is good. It's not good that it was there, but it's good that it wasn't used. The more problematic method was the one that was sending the load URL intent, and this was in WebView. And WebView is a class that is primarily used to render different URLs on Android. And if you want to render any URL in your app, you can use WebView. It's a fairly simple way to render URLs and visit a website. So this load URL method, which just takes an URL. When you have a WebView class, you can load the URL through a load URL method. You give it a string, it loads a URL. Simple as that. So this method had a regular code. The regular code is the first three lines. Is by regular, I mean the same one that's in AOSP. And then it had appended code. And the appended code created an intent and put two extra fields. One was called URL, and the other one was called pack name. And you may recognize these fields from two slides ago. They were the fields that were saved to the database by that device monitoring app. So the URL is the URL that's passed to the method, and the package name is the pack name is the package name of the app that created the web view. So if you're a developer, you create a web view, you view a website, and that package name, not the package name of web view or anything like that, but the package name of the actual app is the package name here. So this was put into the database and sent over to the network, sent over the network to a remote server, which obviously is not good, because that means that all the URLs opened in any apps were sent over the network to a remote server. So what we did in this case, and this is really important, that's why the font is bolded, and the size of the font corresponds to the amount of work that went into that. So we worked with the OEM to provide a system update which removes that additional code and removes the app. In the meantime, the app was flagged by Google Play Protect. That means that users on end devices, on user devices, this app was disabled. There is a slight difference between an app being removed and disabled. Due to the way that system image is created, apps can only be disabled and not removed. I will talk about it later on, but for now, the only difference between disabled and removed is that if the app is disabled, the APK file is still on the device, as in it's still on the file system, but the app doesn't run in any meaningful way. And I will explain why it has to stay on the file system later on. So usually this is where most of the talks end. I still have some time, so. We also took an additional step, or at least I like to take additional step, and understand what was different about this particular app that allows us to improve our systems. You have the finding, you have the remediation, and then you have to kind of do the postmortem and improve the system. So in this case, when you think about emulating such an app, you wouldn't see anything meaningful. Even if you send the intent, you would see only that the intent was sent and it was saved to the database and the data was sent over the network. So the key insight here for me is that if you run an app in the emulator, it may still need some kind of a modification in order to work properly on the system image level. And in other cases, it may need a specific device, a specific hardware, a specific driver, something that's on a system image that it assumes is just there because it's running on that device. And perhaps kind of surprisingly, the app that you will try to install in your emulator and run in your emulator may already be there. It's a system app that we're talking about, so your emulator probably has system UI. It probably has some other apps like calculator or some other apps. So what Android will do in this case when you try to install it, it will say, I already have this app, so are you trying to upgrade this app? If you're trying to upgrade this app, it has to be signed with the same certificate, right? So I want to upgrade this app. It also has to have a version that's higher than the current installed version. So if it doesn't have that, I will also remove this. I will also not install this app. Or it may be compiled against a different API level, because the API level, you know, the device comes with a specific API level and your emulator may have a different API level. So these are all the failures that can happen. And my advice is to think like you were an OEM for your emulated environment. So there are some simple things you can do. You can sign the app with the certificate that's a platform certificate for your particular emulator. If you have your own ASP image, if you have your own emulated device image, you own the keys, right? You're not relying on someone else to provide you with the keys. So you can sign the apps with the platform key. You can install them on the system partition instead of installing them on a data partition. That requires a bit of re-scripting your workflow, but it's definitely possible when we're talking about the emulator, you have access to the whole system image. So thinking about like OEM can give you some simple wins. You can also replace the app that's already on the emulator. If you don't use the standard install flow, you can do that. It's your emulator. You can do whatever you want. But if the Android framework is modified like it was in this case, none of this will help. You can sign it with your platform key. You can do whatever you want. It still won't show you that it's sending all the URLs to a remote server, right? So in this case, I think your best bet is to resort to static analysis, which conveniently is our next case study, and this is Triada. Triada is, I think, the most complex piece of pre-installed malware that I've seen. How many of you have heard about Triada in the Android context? Okay, there's a couple of people. For the rest of you, it's a really exciting piece of malware. So there is a bit of history, and the bit of history starts in 2016. In 2016, Kaspersky discovered this routing trojan, which was just a routing trojan, and by just a routing trojan, I mean it had to be somehow installed on the device, and then it routed the device and did its action. In 2017, in summer of 2017, Dr. Webb described the system-level backdoor, and we also saw that same system-level backdoor that was introduced by the same group that was responsible for Triada. And one of the ways we know that it was the same group is this double XOR loop that you can see here. They were really committed into this form of encryption. It's you know, when you XOR something twice, it's obviously better than XORing something once. And they implemented this double XOR loop in at least three different programming languages, which shows a certain level of commitment to this encryption, right? Of course, not only this double XOR loop wasn't the only thing that linked the routing trojan and the system level backdoor, but we're fairly certain it's the same group of actors. So what was the system level backdoor? And this is really an ingenious way of inserting a system-level backdoor. It was in the log function of the Android framework, the function that you use to log anything when you're an app developer, right? And there was a piece of additional code there, just one line of code that jumped to another set of instructions. And that one line of code was responsible for determining which process wants to log something. And if it's the process that we are interested in, we may run some additional code in that process context, right? So when you think about it, it's really interesting way to put the backdoor into the operating system, because every single app has to log at some point, right? You probably log something if you're an app developer. So this will run in, sooner or later, it will run in every app context. And you can run your code in every app context. So there were two code injections or additional pieces of code that we were able to find. One was in system UI, and this was just a thing to get some kind of an elevated permission that's only a system level permission that is only given to pre-installed app, and it's only given to system UI actually. So this is more of a technicality, but the other injection was to Google Play. And that Google Play code, that was an additional code injected there by Triada, had 10 operations. So it's in reality, it's 5 operations, because all the odd ones are requests and all the even ones are responses. So the operation number one is when you want to download something and you only get two in response. So there is no response to one. So you are able to download an app, to install an app, this wasn't the download and install from Google Play. It was from outside of Google Play. Then there was an activation request. This is an Android thing. When you install an app, it's in a stopped state. You have to click on it in order for it to run. Because Triada was running with elevated privileges, it could effectively do the same thing as user clicking on it. Pull request and pull results is a ping kind of thing. It really didn't do anything apart from the response. And it could also uninstall the app. So it used real unpopular Google package names. By unpopular, I mean the apps that weren't really that popular. But the app had nothing to do with the one that was on Google Play. It just used the same package name. And it used an unpopular one for an obvious reason. If the app is popular, it can be installed on your phone, right? So these two code injections were what Triada was doing, and there was also a bit of a complex communication mechanism. So the injection to play was just communicating with the CNC, and it downloaded the files and installed the apps and all that. It was kind of self-contained. The system UI one, because it had the additional permission that get real tasks. What it did is it exposed that permission to installed apps. So the installed apps that knew about Triada could connect to a socket, a local socket, or send an intent and interact with an app that gave, with a piece of code that gave them that get real tasks permission. And the installed app, of course, communicated with the CNC. It was the same or similar CNC. But the way the installed apps that knew about Triada communicated with the framework backdoor is really interesting. So the app that was installed and knew about Triada could simply log something that was meaningful to the backdoor, right? Because the backdoor saw all the logs. So if they agreed on a specific word or a log line, the app could send that log line and Triada knew what was going on. So this was a one-way communication because obviously the log function cannot really do anything in the other direction. So in the other direction, what they use were Java properties. If you're a Java developer, you may be familiar with this concept of JVM properties. These are pair process properties. So every app gets their own set and you can set these properties. And of course, because the logging backdoor ran as the app in the app context, it could set the properties and the app could see the same properties. So this was like a communication in the other direction, not in the log direction. And what that shows is the level of sophistication that goes into the static analysis. It all started with the single line of code. There wasn't even a pre-installed app. There wasn't anything being preloaded. It was just this single line of code that was responsible for that. And then it led to the additional pieces that you can kind of put together if you have enough data and if you have enough apps. So again, we worked with the OEM. The size of the font corresponds to the number of work we did. We worked with the OEMs to provide system updates which removed the pre-installed backdoor or Triada. And again, I want you to take another step with me and see what that means and what that insight gives you into how to analyze pre-installed threats. But first, a small side story. So I showed you this diagram of like different components coming to the device, and I told you the story of how an Android device is made. And the part of the story was that the OEM wants to have additional software features, and they may not be able to get them themselves. They may not have the resources to do that, so they may subcontract it to someone else. And when they want this software feature, they ship the whole system image to a third party, and then they get back the system image. They put that on the device. They check whether the software feature is there, and it's there. So this is the end of the story. But you can, of course, ship more of the code with that approach. So basically, the third-party vendor can add some malicious code. And if you don't do security audits of your device or don't really look closely at the code that was added, then you don't know what's what's in there. So this piece shows you that the static analysis may be a little bit more involved when it comes to pre-installed apps, and you have to have this holistic look at the whole system image, not at any app in isolation. And that comes back to what I said at the beginning. You cannot treat an app as an independent unit of code. It's within a specific ecosystem. It's not only within Android. It's within this system image. And you also have to take a look at the code that comes from AOSP. This can be modified as a log function was in this case, and the activity and web viewer in previous cases. And you have to try to understand not only the system image as in the binaries that run and processes that run and anything that runs, but you also have to understand the SELinux rules, what is allowed, what is not allowed. And in order to, and this brings us to a third case, which is directly related to what's allowed and what's not allowed. So the case study number three is the app update framework. And this app update framework is a binary. It's not an app, it's a binary. And this binary executes in several stages, and these are the stages that the developers wrote in the code. So these are the names of the stages they used. So it checks the system directory, checks whether it's running in the correct directory. Then it checks the debug status, checks if the device is rooted, adds a signal handler. This is related to the exception handling. And then it creates communicate FIFO, or at least it says create communicate FIFO. So what that means is it creates a file-like object in the data directory that allows it to read whatever you pass to the binary, and another file-like object that allows it to output whatever the binary produced. And then it does some other stuff. But the main point of this is you have a way of communicating with the binary through that FIFO object. And you can get some work done. So what is the communication protocol, or what is the thing that you can put into that binary? And there are two ways of communicating with the binary. One is through that created FIFO, and the other one is when you run the binary with a specific argument. So through that FIFO that I just explained, you can run the argument as a shell script. You can kill a specific process. You can execute anything you want. You can just echo whatever you want. So you can say, hey, print this to the FIFO out. Or you can download a file on the system, on the data partition. If you want to pass something as an argument, you have to run the binary with a specific argument, and then it remounts the system partition as read-write. It downloads a shell script from the CNC or from the server and executes it. It can upload any file to the remote server. It can print the version of the binary, and it can execute the binary given as an argument. So all in all, a pretty powerful binary. Now, the important part that I kind of didn't mention is that this binary ran as root. It had this special privilege in Android ecosystem that no binaries actually use or should use. And this made it possible, when you think about it, to for any other process on the device to pass an argument and execute that with this app privileges, right? So what I did is I ordered the device. And I was all excited. You know, a new device with a vulnerability. I unpacked the device. I connected to it using ADB. I got to ADB shell. I passed the echo command to the FIFO in file. And I looked at the FIFO out file, and it really did print that command. So I was all excited. But what I also did is I created an app to prove that any app can communicate with that binary and put anything in the FIFO in and get the output. And when I ran that app, it crashed. And it crashed, we will go about that in a second. It crashed for a really weird reason, and it crashed because the SELinux didn't allow me to connect to it. And when you look at this log, this particular line of log, you can see that this is denied write for the FIFO in on this device, and the domain which the write was denied from is called untrusted app, so any third party app. And this means that the app, I wasn't able to communicate with that. And when I previously ran something as shell, I also missed the fact that the app actually, that the binary actually drops the privileges to shell when it executes something from shell. So if the calling UID, you can see it's different than root, it will drop the privileges, and the same for group ID. So what that taught me is that sometimes we can make assumptions about the code that's running, and these assumptions may be later verified by SELinux to not be correct. And if you go back to the slide that I showed you just now, the one which kind of did this different command calling with the FIFO in and the arguments. When you think about it, these are two different SELinux operations. One is calling a binary and the other one is writing to a file. So this allows the software developer to provide even greater granularity through SELinux and even greater control. So, fortunately for the users, and a bit unfortunately for me, this wasn't really a vulnerability, and it was properly guarded by SELinux. But there is an interesting point to that, and this is the slide that I omitted. You could communicate with that binary through the dialer. So on Android, you have this option called secret codes, which sounds like something out of a spy movie, and this is just something that starts with a star and star hash, and then you provide some numbers, and then you have hash star. So this dialer exposed a bunch of functions. These were debug functions, so nothing really exciting, but it's still pretty interesting that you could type in a code and communicate with the binary that's on the system image. So again, we work with the OEM. I told you there wasn't a vulnerability, but we just wanted to make sure that the OEM really is aware of that and has proper safeguards in place and all that, so not to expose users to additional problems coming from that binary. But what that taught me, it taught me a very hard lesson that you shouldn't really trust. You should really check everything before you try to exploit the device. And having a proof of concept is a really nice idea. And this brings me to a couple of other things that people usually jump into when they look at the system images. One is build fingerprints. And build fingerprints are these strings which uniquely identify the device model. And I can show you a part of the CTS, which again is the list of requirements for compatibility. And there is one for fingerprint, and it specifies the fingerprint format. Let's make it slightly bigger. And this is just a string that uniquely identifies this build. It should be reasonably human readable. It must follow the template. So we have a template, there's a brand and product and all that. The fingerprint must not include any white space characters. This will be important in a second. And the value of the field must be encodable as ASCII, so no non-ASCII characters. So all these build fingerprints, for different reasons, are not real. I mean, they are real, but they are non-CTS build fingerprints, which means the device wouldn't pass the test. So it just pretends to be a device from this OEM. And when you take a look, for example, at number 17, the number 17 has some non-ASCII characters. The number 15 has a white space. The number 23 also has a white space. There is some insight into number 19. The insight is that Samsung usually uses lowercase Samsung, not uppercase Samsung, when they have a built fingerprint, so it's also not a real built fingerprint. Number 11, if you didn't pay the attention, the first part of the built fingerprint is brand, and the second one is product. So obviously, Samsung is not a good example of a built fingerprint because it doesn't identify the product. And in the number one, there isn't a product called T805S that's coming from Samsung. But interestingly, there is a product called T8055. So the company that made the device tried to spoof another device just by looking similar to another product. But if you see something like that, and for example, you see a headline claiming that a pre-installed malware was found on this, on that, or that phone, it may be a phone that wasn't even produced by that company, and it's just a phone that pretends to be something else. So make sure to check the built fingerprint and not make any assumptions, or look at documentation. There's really extensive documentation for Android that provides you with all these insights that I'm talking about today. Another thing that kind of may go wrong when you're looking at the system image is you may make some assumptions about the live device that you have in your hands and how that live device state corresponds to the system image that was installed on the device. So one of the things you can assume is that if there is anything on system, there is an app on system partition, it comes pre-installed. That may not necessarily be true. So there are routing trojans that can remount the system partition as read-write and put themselves on the system partition. You can see in this IDA screenshot that it does just that. So it remounts the system partition, and you can, if you don't see the first line, it says LUD mount with the options remount and read-write system partition. So the system partition is readable and writable. And LUD is just the name for the SU binary that is used by this routing trojan. So the routing trojan, to make it harder to detect that the phone is rooted, instead of having SU binary, it has LUD binary, which does the same thing, but makes it harder to detect that the phone is rooted. So on newer Android device, you have verified boot, which makes sure that the system image that you have is the same one that was either provided through a system update or the same one that was in the factory when the device was made. And that's why the apps cannot be simply removed from the system image. I told you that I will explain that problem. We cannot influence the system image because it's being signed all the way to the hardware-backed key. So if you try to change anything on a system image, the verified boot wouldn't allow you to do that. But you can disable an app and the app won't run. So effectively it's the same, it's just that the bytes are there. So to sum up very quickly, these are some statistics for 2019. We have more than 2.5 billion devices that we are protecting. They are being scanned for all kinds of threats, not only the apps that you get from the Play Store, but also pre-installed threats. There are more than 3 million pre-installed applications scanned by us in 2019 in the system images and system updates that were submitted to us and went through the BTS that I mentioned in the first couple of slides. And more than 50,000 images were scanned in 2019. Okay, so last two slides for you. If you are a researcher and you're doing Android reverse engineering, there are some key insights you can take from this talk. We definitely need more researchers looking into pre-installed app space in that way and providing high quality content and research. You have to understand a few key differences, but when you do that, when you switch your mind to that mindset, you can really provide the community with some really valuable insights, and makes your work more efficient because you don't have to go back and forth. And the Android ecosystem is definitely vast with the diversity of the OEMs and their customizations. This comes with new and exciting features, and no two Android devices are the same. They have different features for the users, but it also comes with some challenges for us and for security researchers. And if you're not a researcher and you just came here to learn something about the Android system image, build test suite is what we do and what we run on all system images submitted to us. It looks for any pre-installed malware. We are also using in the wild monitoring to see if the devices are infected. Google Play Protect will alert you, so make sure it's on. It will either disable the app or ask you to disable the app or remove the app if it's not a system app. And we are constantly working with the OEMs to get rid of any pre-installed threats and to get rid of anything pre-installed. And we will go to the questions in a second, but in anticipation of your questions, the question that I get asked most frequently is what kind of devices I can use for enterprise. And we have this website, which is for the Android Enterprise. And you can find devices that not only, that not only come with the security, but also come with the features that enterprise usually wants. So take a look at the website, and maybe you will find something for yourself. And that is all. And with that, I welcome any questions you may have. Thank you. Just go back to the first slide. Okay, questions?
So in your analysis of the root privileged, were you able to find any SE permissions that were granted access to run as root that you could abuse or write to, like any temp folder files or constructs?
You mean with the binary that was running as root or?
Yeah.
Yeah. Not really anything that OEM wouldn't have access otherwise. So as long as they knew about this binary and were fine with it and had had control over it, then it's the device manufacturer, basically.
Thanks for the talk. How certain are you that there is nothing missed, that you haven't missed anything? Because some of the backdoors seemed rather complicated. Well, at least to me, I'm not an expert.
But, yeah.
So is it like 100% sure that these images are all good, or you can never be sure?
It's a constant struggle, and I'm discovering the challenges with the Android supply chain constantly. So there may be something new that we don't know about. There may not be something new that we don't know about. It's a really complex space. It's the same as with any malware, really.
Thanks.
Okay, any more questions? We still have 3 minutes. No. Thank you.